Hey there, this is Frank Yosa, CEO of KetoneAid, and today I'm really excited to come back and do more videos. People have been asking for it. We had turned off all video and all advertising because we were virtually sold out ever since the Tour de France revelation that the leaders were using ketone esters. We've been scrambling to catch up, but we now have stuff in stock. Today I actually want to talk about an example of when it did not work. Previously I'd done a video on a few examples of it not working, and I thought I'd hit up a particular example of a marathon race that went not horribly wrong, but not good, pretty bad. And why would I do that? Why would I give you the bad? If I give you the bad, then you can manage your expectations. It's not just this thing like caffeine that you just take it and just will always work, that the protocol matters. So it's managing your expectations, but also emphasizing that you really have to try it first and practice more than one time, not just one time and great, it worked, and then go do it in a marathon and expect, you know, great things. So this marathon runner is, I would say he's professional, semi-pro, and he's not keto. So let's talk about that for a second. Keto, he didn't even know what the word keto was, so I knew that he was not keto because he would know. Keto stands for ketogenic athlete, which is 80%, 75 to 80% fat, 15 to 20% protein, 5% carbs. 80% of our clientele are ketogenic currently, but this drink was actually designed for non-ketogenic athletes, and that really confuses people. It just happens to be that keto people know about it because they know what ketones are, where a non-keto person, it's like, what? Run on fat, eat fat? Like, just so confusing. So this is a non-keto person, so we have a little bit less data, but I gave them some protocols. We have general protocols, and then we kind of break it down into high performance, super expensive protocol versus the microdosing smaller protocol. And I was starting him off on this microdosing protocol. I think it was either 10 or 15 mLs on an empty stomach. He tried it in one or two practices, and he was just loving it, loving the recovery. He's like, this is no placebo. I wish I could get the exact quotes in front of me, but he loved it. And then he decided to go do it in a marathon. Now this guy runs marathons frequently, so it's not something that it was his once a year thing. So it was kind of like a practice for him, but still it was a marathon race. And he wrote back saying it was horrible. And I felt so bad. But you know, we went through, okay, what was the differences? He took this amount, you know, did you do anything different? What'd you eat beforehand? And he said, oh, I had a half of a banana and 3/4 of a power bar. And I was just like, did you do that when you went and did your practice run? He's like, no, but you know, I can't run an entire marathon, you know, without any food. And I said, okay, well, this is an example of you can't change the protocol. And it's kind of good that it happened to him early on, as opposed to just doing months and months of training and having it work in a certain way and then go to a big meet. So it's kind of good that he got it out of his way, an example of it not working. So he changed the protocol. Yes, just that one banana and power bar could be the difference. Now, there could be many other things. He actually even got, I'll say this, he got sick at mile 22. He actually threw up, but he had actually started taking Gatorade halfway through. And you know, I was Googling what are the different ways, reasons you might, you know, throw up in a race, and one of them was nerves. And I said, hey, were you excited at the beginning of the race that you now had this, you know, secret pill that would, you know, make your times, you know, hit new PRs without having to work? And you know, I didn't say it exactly like that, but he said, yeah, I was super, super excited. Well, it turns out that nerves can actually upset your stomach, and just a thousand different variables that could happen in a race that, you know, makes your stomach upset. And him taking 10 mLs 2 hours earlier, you know, who knows if that was part of it or not. But it wasn't just that. It was, he felt flat. He felt just, he didn't feel like it felt in practice, which was, it was just easy. The energy was just there, less effort. He felt like it was more effort, and he was 20 seconds slower. So it was just, it was not good. So yes, something as little as changing the variable of food in your stomach, that has been a constant protocol requirement, is an overnight fast going into your run. Now, over time, different people will, they'll start with the protocol, and then you can shift away from it. And if it doesn't work when you shift away from it, you know, you can't blame us because we didn't suggest that. We actually suggested not doing that. But if it does work, then guess what happens? You will share your protocol on the message boards, or we'll share it for you with your permission. And then that will become part of the protocol if enough people experience that. For example, we found that someone started eating pancakes 3 hours before their 1 hour race, and they were fine. So maybe it doesn't necessarily need to be, you know, an overnight fast, but you know, at least 3 hours of an empty stomach. And water doesn't count, by the way, as an empty stomach. So back to this guy. So it didn't work. He was bummed out, and I think it was because of having food in the stomach. It might have to do with several variables. These are theories. Like, it would take years and years to prove these out with 100 case studies, placebo controlled and stuff. But the theory is that the reason that the microdosing might be working for these athletes, for keto and non-keto athletes, is it might be more of a signaling effect to trigger your own body's endogenous production. Because mathematically, 10 mls, 15 mls, which is like $5 to $7 worth of ketone ester, because everyone thinks it's super expensive, but you know, here's $5 worth, mathematically should not last you 2 hours. So the theory is that it might be triggering your own fat burning, and then you're relying on your fat stores, and you'll have 10, 20, 30, 40 pounds, you know, endless fat stores throughout the race. So that's one theory. And if you do anything like any sort of insulin spike from a banana or a protein bar, I wouldn't have thought so much, you know, beforehand, but that insulin spike can interrupt that process and completely, possibly just shut it down. So yeah, that's the biggest protocol adjustment that people want to make. They read the protocol. It's, you know, pretty detailed of what we suggest for this type of race, this length. And then they say, oh yeah, I did the protocol. Oh, but I had to eat breakfast, because, you know, you have to eat breakfast before an Ironman 4 hour, 6 hour race. It's like, okay, but there's a reason why it's in the protocol. I know it's uncommon, it's hard to digest, no pun intended, but you have to try it in practice and see if it works for you. One person who, you know, followed the protocol, not the microdosing, but the larger one, in a half marathon, all he had at the beginning was, this is the dual fuel protocol, so you take a gel pack and then ketone ester. And then after his 4 hour race, I saw him in line at a buffet, and there was like free lobster. And I said, hey, just want to ask you a question. Are you hungry? And he said, oh my God, I'm not even in the slightest hungry. And I'm just here in line because there's, you know, free lobster. And he had never had a race before, an entire Ironman, where he wasn't hungry. Well, that's consistent with the endogenous production, where your body's making its own ketones and just has, you know, ample fuel towards the end of the race. And that's what you want at the end of the race. So then people ask, well, what can I combine it with carbs along the way? Can I take it, you know, with carbs or carbs first? And you can try those different things and see what works out for you. But keep in mind, towards the end of the race, you're going to have more lactic acid buildup. And that's when the ketone ester and the ketones really start to kick in, because it's a more efficient fuel source that makes 50% less increase in lactic acid. I didn't say 50% less lactic acid, 50% of an increase in lactic acid. But if you start carbing up towards the end of the race, well, won't that just start getting your lactic acid back up again? So you got to try different things to look out for. If you feel too flat, which is what I told this athlete, hey, if you feel flat, your blood sugar might be down too much, then you might want to start carb loading, because, you know, you got to bring your blood sugar back up. You can't run at a, you know, 50, 60, 70. Even after him adding the carbs back, it didn't help. Now, whether it would have kept him from dropping out of the race, you know, who knows? But ultimately he was, you know, a few minutes slower than his normal marathon pace, but he was expecting to, you know, hit new PRs. So you really want to try it multiple ways, practice trying to recreate the race as much as possible, everything from time of day to length of the race. And I know with marathon runners, oftentimes, you know, their long day will be only 20 miles, but, you know, don't be just trying it on a 10 mile run and then expect magically it to do the same thing on a marathon run. So you can email me directly, frank@ketoneaid.com, and make sure to join our group on ketoneaid.com. Click on the top for community, and it goes to a Facebook group, and you'll see other people trying it. And when people have negative experiences, we actually ask them to post it to see if other people can, and myself, can chime in on what adjustments to make. And keep in mind that more is not always better. It's just the tendency is, oh, if I just take a couple ml more, 5 ml more, that doesn't work. You can drop your blood sugar too much. You have to find that right balance for you. And everyone's different. Everyone has different levels of sensitivity. Andrew Triana, a strongman, he's down in the 5 to 7 mls and swears by it. And he knows his body, super body sensitive. And, you know, he swears by that amount. So everyone's different. They want this holy grail chug and go thing. And it's just more difficult than that. And our protocols protocols are wildly different than our competitors. Their protocol is just to, you know, keep it simple, stupid, keep the box simple, open bottle, chug entire bottle and go. But I think that's way, way, way too much, way too expensive, and won't increase performance unless you're doing the dual fuel, which is a more complicated and takes even more months to do. But I really hope that we can start showing some of the success stories on here. We had a marathoner recently that just shattered their marathon record professional, and hopefully we'll get them on the podcast to talk about it. But you know, sometimes athletes, professional athletes, don't want to necessarily reveal all their tricks, and right now we're not sponsoring anybody, so we don't pay people to say certain things, so it's just, you know, having them talk about their experience honestly. Thanks again. Bye-bye.